Welcome to another episode of Veterans Views. Our guest tonight is Dr. Paul Thomas. Dr. Thomas served in the United States Army from 1942 until 1970. During this interview, our viewers will have a chance to become a bit more familiar with the young Paul Thomas and the interesting path of his achievements throughout his military career. Dr. Paul Thomas, when we return. Welcome back to our episode with Dr. Paul Thomas. Dr. Thomas, can you share the beginnings of your military life and how it became a part of your life?
Absolutely. Graduated from high school in 1941, was expected to go to college, but I stayed out of school for a year. December, Pearl Harbor of 42. I was already finishing the first semester of school at Penn State as an engineering student. Signed up for the Army Enlisted Reserve, did not sign up for classes for my second semester, and was ordered to active duty. Went in the Army, assigned to the Army Air Corps, trained as a bombsight and automatic pilot technician. And I worked first on B-29s and then at the end of the war on B-17s first and then B-29s.
Where were you stationed?
I was stationed, first I had my training in Denver, Lowry Field. I went from there to Big Spring, Texas, where they had a bombardier school. Then I went to Avon Park, Florida, where they had B-17 staging for crew members. And then I went from there to Gulfport, Mississippi, where they had the B-29s.
Did you ever serve in the European theater?
No, I never left the States.
Never left the States.
But in 1946, after the war was ended, I was discharged from my Army, and I used the GI Bill to complete my education. I went to George Washington University. First, I was a chemistry major. Decided during the years in school that I wanted to go to medical school, and that's what I did.
One of the things that you were sharing with me prior to our conversation here is that while you were in the program or the maintenance doing your job down in Gulfport, you thought it'd be kind of interesting to see about how it would be to be airborne or just up out of a plane.
Yes.
What happened there?
I was detailed to flight test, and the responsibility of flight test was to take the B-29 out of depot maintenance and certify that everything was in order. And part of that certification required 3 hours of flying, where our crew looked at everything. And I was the one who set up the bombsight and the automatic pilot while we were flying. What I told you is one day we had a ship where the bomb bay doors would close but not latch. And the captain said, "Paul, go back and pull the emergency relief in the bomb bay." I strapped the parachute on my back and I went through the catwalk getting around to the front where the control was, looking down. I thought up until that moment that it would be fun to jump out of an airplane with a parachute. With the wind blowing up through my you-know-what and looking down, no way. No way. I don't want to jump.
You decided against it.
And so I pulled the emergency leave. Well, the bomb bay doors closed, but they still wouldn't latch. And the captain asked me to just stay where I was till we landed, which we did safely. No problem. But that cured me of any desire to be a parachute jumper.
You mentioned something about the maintenance and you were certifying the planes.
Yes.
Did the Army certify all their planes before they got shipped overseas?
Oh, yes.
How long of a process was that? And how many planes do you remember certifying?
Well, I don't know how many we did, but we re- we were required to put them in the air three separate times for an hour each. I would say 30 or 40% of them we turned down even before we took off.
Really?
Oil leaks and one thing or another that we found, sent them back and had things taken care of. But no, that was a very important part of aircraft maintenance.
You mentioned after the service, you went back to school and you were a chem major. And then you decided that you wanted to go into medical school.
Yes.
When, at what point in your studies, or perhaps when you graduated med school, that you decided to return to the Army, and why?
As I say, I used a GI Bill as far as it would go, and I borrowed money for the tuition to finish my last year of medical school. When I graduated in 1952, I had family and no means of support. And so I just signed up in the Army and went back in the Army where they gave me my internship and my surgical training while in the Army, and then served the rest of my time.
So you're usually, basically, the Army was your residency and your internship.
Yes.
Where were you stationed for that particular phase of your military life?
I went from Washington, D.C. to Brooke Army Hospital in San Antonio for my internship. From there, I went to Tripler Army Hospital in Honolulu for my surgical residency. I came back to Brooke assigned to the surgical research unit. And from there, then I went to Denver to Fitzsimmons Army Hospital, where I finished my cardiothoracic surgery training.
I imagine that you would have liked to stay in Hawaii your whole career.
Oh, well, that was pretty good. But as I finished, then I was ordered to go to Vietnam for a year.
And that was in what year?
I went 62-63.
And your function or your responsibilities in Vietnam?
I was head of a chest surgery team. It was attached to the 8th Field Hospital, which was the first United States military hospital in the theater. And we set up in the Trang on the South China Sea, north of Saigon, south of the other big cities. And that's where we were for a little more than a year before coming back.
At that time, were you treating American casualties or South Vietnamese Army casualties?
Well, we had both. We had some American casualties. Most of our troops were there as advisors at that time. We hadn't committed combat troops. But our people went to the Vietnamese Army Hospital and helped them with their casualties, as well as taking care of our own. It turned out, from my perspective, professionally, that it was a good year.
While you were stationed in Vietnam, did the hospital engage in any programs that went to the villages to deliver health care to the people in the villages, or did they come to the hospital?
No, just not our hospital unit, but the Army advisors were with them. I did go to their largest military hospital in Saigon a time or two to visit and look at what they were doing and give some advice. And I had a close relationship with a Vietnamese surgeon who was active in Saigon working. So we did what we could to help them.
While you were stationed at the Safe Field General Hospital or Field Hospital,
yes.
Was it at a support base? Was it in a village? Was it a standalone unit?
It was in a village as a standalone unit.
So there was really no protection, was there?
Well, I guess we had some.
Some.
We didn't worry about that.
I think an interesting point of that time frame, it was just before the buildup of sending U.S. troops there.
Yes.
As an individual, as a military officer, as a doctor, did you share any concerns with the rest of the staff that there might be a buildup or that was gravitating toward a more commitment from America?
That was not within my knowledge and experience.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I didn't have the opportunity to do anything like that.
Was it rather peaceful where you were?
Relatively.
And
there
what kind of...
There was activity.
What kind of creature comforts did you have there?
Tent city.
Tent city. Okay. There was no restaurants, there was no...
Well, not with us. We could go into Natrang if we wanted to.
Was it pretty safe then to do that?
You know, I didn't go in there almost never. But, I will tell you about one of our own casualties. We had a helicopter pilot shot from the ground by a Vietnamese while he was flying, and the slug went into his rear end and up into his abdomen. He came into the hospital bleeding, and our people took care of him. He had bleeding from his kidney, and they stopped that and stabilized him, and we sent him back to the States after 5 or 6 days. When he got back, he was taken care of at Walter Reed. They found that that kidney that was injured did not function. And the kidney was removed surgically, and lo and behold, they found that kidney had a cancer. I don't know what ultimately became of the patient, but just one of those things that stands out in your mind as something extremely remarkable.
What was the main mission of your particular field hospital? Was it to...
It was to support our troops in the field.
As far as the casualties, though, was it meant to be a place where they were convalescent?
No, just acute care. And then get them stabilized and get them moved back to the States as soon as it's reasonable.
What were the number of staff personnel that you had at your hospital about?
Oh, I never thought of that. In total, we had, I would say, 20 or 25 physicians. But I don't know about the numbers of the other parts of the staff.
When I was in Vietnam, I was more familiar with evac hospitals.
Yes.
Like the 93rd or the 80th.
Right.
Well, how did your hospital differ in the mission from an evac hospital?
It was smaller, and it was more ready for acute injuries online as opposed to the evac hospital, where they would take care of people with all kinds of medical conditions in addition to surgical problems. But ours was designed more for surgical treatment, emergency treatment.
After your tour in Vietnam, did you ever have a desire to return?
I've thought about that from time to time. I've never really taken the issue seriously, but I've wondered if I went back and looked around how things would be as opposed to when we were there. I haven't done it.
After your tour in Vietnam, you mentioned that you were in the service until 1970.
Yes.
What were your other assignments?
Well, I came back from Vietnam and was assigned to Valley Forge Army Hospital. And for a while, I was head of the cardiothoracic surgery division, and then became chief of surgery. That's how I functioned until I got ready to retire.
Would you, as reflecting upon your career in the military, do you believe you had a lot of opportunities to gain knowledge or enhancement of your specialty?
Absolutely. Oh, I wouldn't trade my time in the military for anything I know that would have been an alternative. I had a very good career, and I had good training, and I had good experience totally. And I look back on that, and I think that was great. And that prepared me, gave me the freedom to not have to make a lot of money when I got out of the service, so I went into academic medicine.
Oh, okay.
And for a while I was at Jefferson Medical College affiliate in Philadelphia, and then I came to the University of Illinois in Chicago in 1970.
As a teacher, so to speak.
Well, yeah. As a surgeon, yeah. A teacher, mm-hmm. And a research person.
Yeah. Reflecting on your experiences, would you recommend the military path to today's young individuals that want to become doctors or nurses in the military?
Absolutely. Absolutely. No question about it, hands down.
What would you tell them?
I would tell them that this is an opportunity to gain the experience that you will use in your after military life and whatever you choose to do in medicine or whatever your career is going to be. It gives you a background and some freedom to make some choices that you wouldn't have going out of medical school right into some other place.
Recently, you were among some veterans that were honored during a Memorial Day parade in Western Springs.
Yes.
And somehow you ended up being the spokesperson for those World War II veterans. You mentioned some facts or some interesting comments about your service to America and what America stands for. Would you share those views with the viewer?
Well, absolutely. We have our freedom in this country based on the fact that military people have sacrificed through hundreds of years to provide that, and it is a freedom that does not exist anywhere else in the world, and we are absolutely fortunate to have been born and lived in this country, for goodness sakes. It's, as far as I'm concerned, no better place in the world to live than the United States.
True patriot. Thank you. That was very nice. Any closing comments that you want to share with the viewer?
Well, what I would want to say is that I look back on my career, including my time outside of the military service, and I've done some crazy things, but I don't think I would want to change a month of my life for anything that I can think of as an alternative. It's been great.
As a true American citizen, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for accepting our invitation to be a guest on the show.
Sure.
And folks, please watch that. And when you watch it, share this, when you see that, share this with your friends and family. Very interesting individual, Dr. Paul Thomas. Three campaigns that he served in, serving America, and he loved every minute of it. Thank you, and hope to see you next time.